Beyond, and hello, everyone. My name is Jonathon Dornbush, and this is Podcast Beyond, episode 707. I keep wanting to accidentally say 600, but we're in the 700s now. I got to get used to that. Talking about all the latest PlayStation news, releases, and more right here on IGN and YouTube. Of course, you can also find us on all your favorite podcast services. And why am I doing the end of the show now? Well, because we're ending the show right now. It's the quickest episode in Beyond history. No, we actually have quite a bit to talk about this week. I'm joined this week by Brian Altano.
Hey, what's up, Beyond?
Beyond, Lucy O'Brien.
Hi, hello from New Zealand.
Hello, Lucy, and Max Scoville.
I'm also in New Zealand. I moved all of my dolls and things there, and I'm also, Hi.
It's an incredible one-to-one that you were able to do from your previous home, so congratulations on that. But no, Lucy, thank you for joining us in quite a different time zone and through your internet wife or your hotel internet to be here.
Yeah, it's actually doing quite well. I thought it was gonna, I'm in Christchurch, I'm in mandatory quarantine, so that's why if you're watching this on video, my background looks extremely different to my usual white nothingness. Yeah, I'm in quarantine. The internet is holding up okay, but fingers crossed. Fingers crossed.
Yes, we'll see what happens. And so if you hear any or see any technical difficulties as the show goes on, please bear with us. But yeah, we have quite a bit to talk about this week. We're going to get to the, I think, biggest PlayStation news of the week in just a second. But I do want to briefly just follow up on last week's episode, where, of course, we talked a little bit about the whole Kojima conspiracy that is Blue Box Studios and Abandoned. We don't think it is actually Kojima. But anyway, they were supposed to put out a trailer app for their horror game Abandoned the day after we recorded our episode. Of course, we were saying unless it gets delayed, and lo and behold, it did get delayed until August. It got delayed the day it was supposed to go up, which, like, not the best timing to communicate that when all eyes are on you. But communication about this game has definitely been not one of its highest points, suffice to say. I think I mostly wanted to bring this one up to one. Something we didn't mention on the show that I think a few people I saw in the YouTube comments mentioning was that, oh, PlayStation is giving all this game backing, though, so it has to be a big thing. There was a PlayStation blog post, and they're creating this trailer app, not PlayStation. There are a lot of games you probably have never heard of that also had PlayStation blog posts that you just don't remember. And like that is a very more common thing, and we're actually going to talk about that a little bit later in the show, though maybe about the barrier to entry to do so for that. But it is a thing that doesn't guarantee that Sony is funding this game in any way. So I just want to put that out there.
I got a question. Did they put up a trailer for the trailer app?
Not yet. No.
I mean, if I'm going to download an app, I got to know what I'm getting in for, you know?
Exactly.
They put up a short film of a man describing why you couldn't watch the trailer app for 2 more months, despite it being supposed to launch that day, which is like, I feel like it's incredibly poor taste. I'll just flat out say that. But to not communicate that earlier and to do that the morning of, I mean, there were people being like, what time do you think it goes live? 9 a.m. or what about, you know, midnight New Zealand time or whatever? And they're like, no, it's just not going to be here for 2 months. Like, how did they not know until that morning that it wasn't going to be ready for 2 more months? That's kind of insane.
Yeah,
feel like I want to see a documentary behind this whole, like, thing. It just feels like everyone has been scrambling. There have been so many sort of threads of miscommunication, and yeah, I would love to hear. It's very, you know, Trump ends up at the landscaping thing. it's got that vibe, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's in a strange scenario where, like, I certainly feel for the dev who didn't expect all of these eyes on them in a way that is questioning their own existence. Like, this is definitely a guy who for weeks now has been told, you're not real, you're an actor. And that probably grates on a person. I can very much, like, understand and sympathize with that. But I agree with you, Brian. Like, this was definitely something they probably had to have known before the minute they were going to launch.
Yeah.
And knowing how many eyes are on them, they should have just said, couple days ahead, hey, we have to push this even more. It's a weird case and a weird scenario, and obviously when that trailer app, if it ever goes live at this point, we'll keep an eye on it if it doesn't just become a normal trailer they put up at some point on YouTube. But
hold on. So would you say it's a some sort of a playable teaser?
Don't you start. Don't, they're going to think you're Kojima now.
You know who's behind this, don't you? It's the Patriots and the Lale Lule Lolos. They're doing it again, and all information is fake, and you can find out more on the Death Stranding subreddit.
This is going to get picked up on the subreddit for sure. No, but I will say, in terms of the whole Silent Hill conspiracy aspect of it, I would look more toward the agreement that we saw pretty recently, aka this morning as we're recording, that Konami has partnered with Bloober Team, the team behind the Medium and other various horror games, to work together in a partnership. And I don't know, Konami really doesn't seem to have a ton of horror franchises to pull from, that a first-person horror and third-person action horror, studio might want to work on.
I mean, we've talked about this for a long time. Like, I remember talking about, like, whether or not Bluebeard should tackle Silent Hill, like, several episodes back.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. This has been a thing that they were rumored to be doing for quite some time, and this just feels like the official announcement of the partnership, so that when they announce the game later, it's not, like, totally out of the blue.
I hope it's an Observer pachinko machine, and we're all wrong, you know?
I will point out that, like, the sort of, like, ethical concept of Bomberman is scary. Like, that idea of sort of 64 identical men trying to kill each other with explosives is, you know, theoretically a dark prospect.
In a very small, contained environment.
I think a lot of people have been asking for a first-person Castlevania where you don't have a whip or anything, you know? Just you have to, you know, survive all those bats and stuff by yourself.
Where Simon Belmont just walks around and just slowly mumbles about how bad things got.
Yeah, you gotta hold the right trigger to peek inside a wall, see if there's chickens in there, you know?
There used to be food here.
We can only hope all our game design dreams come true. But yeah, that to me at least feels like, if you're looking for an actual, like, fire behind the smoke, that feels like probably a better place to look than...
So there was a lot of backlash about this, because I think that people don't really like... or they don't think that Bloober is sort of like the team that should be there for Silent Hill. I'll devil's advocate, give them a chance, like, see what they're capable of doing. I have a feeling they'll staff up and they'll be able to do something new. Also, it's been such a long time since we've had, like, a traditional Silent Hill game. Even PT wasn't really a traditional Silent Hill game, although it was, you know, sort of one of the most brilliant horror experience we've seen in this medium, no pun intended. But I enjoyed the medium for the most part. I think that Blair Witch, like, had a lot of really cool stuff going on for it. It was kind of an almost... They did a phenomenal job of building mood in that game. And I think that that's one of the things I think of first when it comes to Silent Hill. It's also like that, you know, that's a franchise that's kind of in disarray and has been for a while. Like, there's DLC for Dead by Daylight. There's the Silent Hill Collection, which... is a bad port and the only real way to, like, kind of revisit those games. It's also still $30, which is annoying. I went to peep that this morning to see if I could just, like, jump back in and replay those games, because it's been so long, and I was like, I don't know if I want to spend $30 on, you know, two games from several generations ago. But this is apparently not the only Silent Hill game being worked on right now. There's also a VR one. And there's also these rumors that, like, a Japanese studio is working on one of the games. So I don't know if, like, Bloober is making a VR Silent Hill, if a Japanese studio, like, that we got some answers here, but I feel like there's also, you know, this spirals off into more directions. And then whatever the hell the abandoned thing is. So,
but yeah, I completely just want to add to that, that, you know, I don't really care who handles a new Silent Hill game, as long as it's not, like, an homage. Like, I want it to be an interesting development and evolution for that series. Like, I guess my one fear with, you know, having a Western developer attached, because we have seen previous Silent Hill games with Western devs attached, and it always felt a little bit like, yeah, like an homage. Like, they were just trying to sort of recapture something that was very organic in the first place and not really evolving it at all. And, you know, what was so exciting about PT was that Kojima seemed to be taking it in a very new direction. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I'm excited that we're getting, like, I'm excited whenever anyone is talking about Silent Hill, because I love that series. But at the same time, like, I'm really hoping to see some evolution there.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, isn't it? Go for it, Jonathon.
I was just going to say, speaking to your point of, like, there are reports, I think Video Game Chronicles had the report, as they've previously been reporting on Silent Hill, that, yeah, there seemed to be other projects in the works. And so I think, like, to your point, that it's a bit of a like, what is the identity of Silent Hill? I think Konami is trying to figure that out too, and it seems like the answer is probably going in a few directions, and we might see what sticks, and that kind of ends up being the future of what this franchise is.
You know what's not silent? I'll tell you, hundreds of chrome balls rattling through a pachinko machine, but why not try a new direction for that quiet, quiet franchise? The Loud Mountain of Pachinko coming up from Konami. I mean, they make pachinko machines. It's a joke, but I'm just saying they do that.
No, yeah, it could. No, I mean, no. We can get a Silent Hill water bottle and treadmill machine or whatever else Konami's strange business.
No, I mean, like they are the keepers of some of the most beloved video game franchises ever that are all sort of in limbo right now. Like it's such a bummer. I mean, watching like the Metroid Dread stuff out of E3, I was kind of sitting there being like, where's Castlevania? You know, like there was. Yeah. And I've mentioned this before, but like, and I don't think I realized how good I had it in the moment, or us Castlevania fans had it in the moment. But there was a couple years there where we were getting a brand new, just really awesome 2D Castlevania game across the GBA and the DS for years. We got like six of them, and they're great. They hold up tremendously well. They haven't figured out how to port them to modern consoles or make a collection. They aren't fast tracking sequels or anything.
There is, in a couple territories, in a Castlevania Advance Collection has been rated by a couple ratings board. So I am hoping that those are getting ported to at least PC, but hopefully consoles too.
Me too.
I always wanted to see what they look like, you know, just on a screen with lights that come out of it. So
yeah, actually see the games. Yeah. I had the worst Game Boy, like, plug-in light frame.
Oh, I had that.
Yeah, just to be able to actually see those games. But yeah, they're phenomenal. It is a very strange case, and I think we're going to keep covering it, obviously, as we hear more officially. But I just want to follow up on that, as we did spend a little bit of time on Abandoned last week. Moving to a game that isn't abandoned at all and has, in fact, been acquired, to pick up another A name. Returnal, the devs behind Returnal, Housemarque, have been officially acquired by PlayStation. They are now an official part of the PlayStation Studios family of studios. So they join, obviously, first-party teams like Naughty Dog and Bend and Sucker Punch, Insomniac and whatnot. It's really awesome to see Sony pick them up alongside, and we'll talk about both aspects of this. Alongside that announcement was a now-deleted tweet from PlayStation Japan that also welcomed Bluepoint Games, the Demon Souls remake creators, to the PlayStation family as well. The thing that makes people think that was more than just a typo is because they actually had a bespoke new image that had all of the sort of like PlayStation Studios lined up, included Demon's Souls in there, had them have the Bluepoint logo on there. So we're potentially looking at Bluepoint also being officially acquired, presumably an announcement sometime to come soon, if that is the case. But as of right now, we know Housemarque has been picked up, and I, for one, I'm really excited by this. I've loved Housemarque for quite some time on PlayStation, and at least from my end, and Brian, I'll start with you in terms of like these deals, it sort of felt like Returnal and Demon's Souls, also to another extent, if Bluepoint turns out to be true, were sort of like the final test beds of like, okay, we kind of want this deal to happen, but let's see what you do with our brand new hardware. And
right,
both were hits, both were critically acclaimed, and it felt like, okay, that seals the deal.
Yeah, no, Returnal is one of my favorite games this year. It's one of the best PS5 games. It's Housemarque. Right before Returnal came out, I went like kind of on a download spree and re-downloaded every old Housemarque game that I could get my hands on. Most of them I had purchased already, so it was easy to do that. And like, they have such an awesome pedigree, and I really love their approach to sort of taking this like 80s, 90s arcade design philosophy and modernizing it. And also on a personal level, it's just super cool to see hard work pay off and be rewarded. This is a studio that has been consistently awesome, but also very openly had like financial troubles and, you know, had dabbled in making mobile games, chasing the battle royale craze and shit like that. And it was just like, it's so cool to see them not have to worry about that. Like they moved in with the family that's going to take care of them. They're going to get support. They're staffing up. Which is part of the announcement, is like they're bringing new people on. They already said they're working on a new project that isn't a sequel to Returnal. It's going beyond Returnal, whatever that means. And I love this. I love this. This is such a cool sort of feather in the cap of what Sony's doing, to join like all of their studios and stuff like that. And you know, for so many people, The Sony third, you know, first party studios are basically just like long story driven, sad dad stories. And there was a, you know, some sad mom stuff in Returnal for sure. And, you know, it is a third person, you know, kind of bleak, sad game in a lot of ways. But also, like, this is a studio that just knows how to have fun with the sort of arcade genre. And I can't wait to see what they do next. I'm so happy for them that they get to continue to grow and evolve and stick to their guns and make cool stuff. That's like the best news in the world you can possibly ask for a studio like this.
Yeah, I'm really excited for them, to your point of like having that backing, because Returnal felt like the first step in their new era where they do have this arcade DNA, and I think that's going to continue to be part of their games. But to have the backing and the support and the stability, I think that's something that we've seen on both sides. Like, Tim Schafer was very open about like wanting to join Xbox after like Double Fine notoriously like stayed independent very specifically for a long time, but because it meant he didn't have to worry about also pitching the next game to be able to get funding for it. They could just have that funding and security back there. And so, especially for a smaller team like Housemarque, who's been putting in the work for years, who has been like, I think, a stalwart of, you know, like a high point of both the PS4's launch day and now, you know, the first 6 months of the PS5 and been on PS3 and Vita as well. Like, I'm very, very happy for them, and I'm excited to see what comes from them next.
It's charting their evolution has been fascinating too. Like, Returnal is such a step up over anything else that they've made before. And that's, I can't wait to see them grow. Like, that's so cool.
So I'm looking
Max,
at the-
For some reason to me, oh no, you go ahead, Max.
I was going to say, just talking about sort of the evolution of the studio, both Housemarque and Bluepoint, this is not really that surprising, because they've both been, I would say, sort of primarily in bed with Sony for around 15 years each. I mean, the majority of things that Housemarque has put out have been PlayStation exclusive. There's Super Stardust HD. There was the PSP version. There was Dead Nation, which was across all the PlayStation platforms. They made a bunch of Vita games. The exceptions here are really like the Angry Birds trilogy and Outland, which was multi-plat. They've clearly been like really like they've been pretty tight with Sony. Like, they've been making lots of, you know, PlayStation 4 exclusives or PlayStation 3 exclusives. And then looking at Bluepoint, I mean, obviously they're a port house for the most part, but they do really good ports. The only ports they've done that weren't for a PlayStation system were the Metal Gear Solid HD collection and the 360 version of Titanfall. But like everything else that they did has been a PlayStation game. So it feels less like, I mean, obviously this is, you know, this is an acquisition and it's cool. They're going to have some more money to throw around and they have the security of that. But like, this feels more like a, you know, yeah, Jon Snow is part of the family. This sort of like, you know, bastard stepkid is allowed to, you know, come to Christmas officially. Like, he gets to be in the Sears portrait studio photo. Like, it's,
yeah, you know, like it's more your than friends that, yeah, that were engaged for a long time get married.
Yeah,
like,
exactly. You know, yeah.
Yeah. Well, and then it's similar to, sorry, Lucy, go ahead.
Yeah. I just wanted to add that, like, I feel like, so this is a very simplistic observation, so I apologize in advance, but it feels like, you know, Sony is starting to, it's very MCU-ish. Like, it felt like with the Ratchet and Clank, when you power that up and you see the Sony Studios logo, and it's very much like the Marvel Studios logo, and like they're getting all these kind of smaller developers under their wings, you know, like how the MCU is getting like Taika Waititi and perhaps less known directors under their wing, right? It's like, and all of a sudden you're getting these very tonally different films, and under the PlayStation banner you're getting these very tonally different games. And I think that's really exciting and interesting, but like from the outside, that is, it's starting to feel very MCU-y.
Right.
I mean, yeah. I think it's very much like a, we used to have that sort of, you know, only on PlayStation, that sort of Nintendo seal of approval kind of graphic that you'd see on things. And this is, I mean, you know, by having a really cohesive first party kind of label, it's really being like, this is, you can expect a certain level of quality from this. And I, you know, I wonder if they just sort of looked at their long running relationship with Housemarque and Bluepoint and they were just like, yeah, you passed the test. You can come hang out, you know.
But don't you think they're leaning into it from like a marketing angle?
Oh,
you know,
totally.
As soon as that Ratchet, like for me, it was that Ratchet and Clank Sony Studios thing. I was just like, oh, okay.
I mean,
this is what you're doing.
I think there's always been some confusion among players you know, obviously we're pretty close to this, but like what constitutes a first party game versus a game that is exclusive to a platform, you know?
Right.
If you can only play it on PlayStation and you start up your system and it has the PlayStation logo and then you play the game, but it was developed by people who don't work for PlayStation, they just made a PlayStation game. That's, you know, that's not a first party thing. It's just, you know, it's just exclusive. But, you know, then you can have, I don't know, it's, it, it that doesn't, like you get, you'd get the PlayStation startup logo on every, you know, PS1, PS2, PS3 game. Like there's always a, there's that thing there. And it's just sort of, it's kind of nice that they have like a really, it is cohesive branding to be like, hey, this is one of our games. You can only get this here. You know?
It's absolutely an evolution of the Nintendo seal of quality. Mm-hmm. Like it's absolutely that.
Well, we don't buy games in boxes anymore. So having a little sticker on the top that says only on PlayStation doesn't work, because if you're buying it from the PlayStation store, you're not checking to see if it's on the Xbox Marketplace or Steam or whatever. So having this thing get in your face when you first start it up to be like, ah, I can only get this here. And yeah, I mean, PC in 2 years, you know.
Acquiring them, I think also, like, Lucy, to your point, it's assembling the team who have been sort of a part of it, you know, for some time. And I think, like, this has bumped those people up to that next level. Like you were saying, I think most of the MCU directors now are people who did one indie movie. There was a joke on, I'm watching Hacks on HBO Max, and there was a joke about how like someone did one indie film and now she's doing the next Marvel movie. And like, that's been the thing with the MCU is you do an indie movie that's really critically acclaimed. You win an Oscar if you're Chloe Zhao, and then you direct a Marvel movie. And so I like Returnal and Demon's Souls were, I think, both really big hits. And I think are kind of looked at as the next gen games right now, like other now and Ratchet and Clank, of course, but those were the two not owned companies by Sony. And if Sony just acquires them, then yeah, they are the face of what next-gen games are looking like right now. And that can go a long way for marketing, because I am honestly sure that, like, you know, as long as those studios remained independent and seeing the acclaim that Returnal and Demon's Souls got and seeing the work that they put in, probably other people want to work with Housemarque and Bluepoint. And that's a matter of Sony probably saying, well, we want to make sure we're always going to be able to work with them. And their teams that probably could use the backing and the funding and security, because that's, you know, something these teams probably love to have.
I can't help but wonder how long this has been in talks, because Returnal, again, it's like that is the biggest Housemarque game to date, and Demon's Souls.
It's been in talks since late last year.
Okay. Yeah. But I mean, I wonder if it was just sort of like, okay, you shipped a launch title, welcome aboard. But, or if this was even just like a conversation prior to that, but.
Apparently they were talking about it towards the tail end of development for Returnal, and then and this is where it gets confusing to me, kind of put it aside so the team could finish the game, I guess, instead of just being like, hey, you might have to, you know, move soon or something like that, or like, you know, we might have a new like if your studio gets bought out and things change. It was too much to sort of shake up when they were just sort of at the finish line of dragging the game to go gold, which I guess makes sense, because like if they're hiring new people and stuff like that, that creates a lot of new dynamics in a studio. That's pretty cool that not only were they were like, hey, this is kind of on the horizon right now, but also finish what you're working on. We'll see how it does, and then we'll talk. And then it sold, Returnal sold really well, which is great, you know.
Yeah.
For like a $70 punishing arcade game. Basically.
Yeah. It really put Housemarque on the map in a way that I think like they've been critically acclaimed for a while, but matching that with some commercial success will really go along, I think, in the future. And Lucy, to your point, I think like immediately, even if they don't, you know, continue with Returnal, I think like making Housemarque and Returnal and Celine a part of this brand that you now know as part of the MCU of PlayStation makes a lot of sense for them going forward. And Bluepoint's an interesting one too, where as Max, you were looking into their history, like they are pretty much known for remasters and remakes. I wonder if that's what continues from them, because they sure know how to do it really, really well. And there are a bunch of old PlayStation franchises people want to see, but like it's also a talented studio, and I wonder what their inclinations are to doing an original project as well. And maybe this offers them security to do both of those things.
Okay, so I'm looking at the PlayStation 5 launch games. This might be a little bit tinfoil hat, but I feel like if this trend continues, it would not surprise me one bit to see Sony scoop up Sumo Digital and Young Horses, because Sumo Digital did, you know, Sackboy's Big Adventure, which, you know, I mean, this isn't, you know, there's no indication that like a company that makes a launch title for a platform would be necessarily acquired, but I feel like, you know, Sumo also did Little Big Planet 3, and they've, you know, got a look, you know, long track record. And looking at Young Horses, who did Bugsnax, which was kind of a surprise, you know, launch game, and it was also like free out the gate. They have a history of doing, like, Octodad was using PlayStation Move support. They had a, I don't know if that was exclusive specifically, but like,
I think it might have launched console exclusive.
Yeah, PS4, I mean, that
was an early game for
it's PS4. You know, an existing relationship there. I'm just gonna say that now, and if it happens, somebody remind me that I said it.
We can point back here. Yeah, Young Horse is an interesting one. Like, having talked to that team a bunch, I wonder like how much they would value the independence over the security of that stuff, and I'd be very curious to see where they go in the future. I'm very excited for whatever comes next from them as someone who loved Bugsnax a lot. Sumo's an interesting one because, yeah, they now have a very long-standing Sackboy and Little Big Planet relationship, but they are like a much more much wider company than just that. Like, they, I think Sumo were also the people who made Hood recently. Like, they've acquired several studios. Like, they are a big company into themselves. So I almost wonder if that just remains a partnership at this point.
Yeah, that could also check out. But I mean, if you, I feel like in a lot of ways, Young Horses has like a very Double Fine kind of energy to them. Like, they're very wacky, for sure. And you know, you look at a lot of sort of Sony's other stuff, and it's very, you know, it's very, very polished, and you know, AAA and shiny and clean, and sort of to have like the, you know, to have sort of a class clown in their portfolio would be, you know, a good addition.
Yeah.
I like the idea of Celine joining the sort of like PlayStation Avengers, because it's like you have all these people that are like wrought with trauma, and then like these, you know, people being like, oh God, Kratos is like, my wife died, and then like fucking Joel's like, my daughter died, and Celine's like, I've canonically been killed hundreds of thousands of times and lived through every second of it. It fucking sucks.
And then they pan over to like, they pan over to the one of the Bugsnax, and he's like, I have hot dogs for hands. The sliding scale of tragedy in PlayStation.
Oh my God. Ranking the most tragic
one thing that, like, the one thing that I've consistently heard from like devs who have worked under the Sony banner is that they have always been afforded a great deal of creative freedom. Like, that is what I've heard. I mean, that is just what I've been told from speaking to people at, like, Media Molecule, for example, that there is, you know, there is little interference from that, like, company. So when it comes to acquiring smaller, scrappier studios, I'm not overly concerned that Sony is going to, like, try and steer them towards a certain type of Sony game. I think that there is a degree of understanding that, you know, they should be allowed to go out and do what and make what they want to make.
Yeah, I think in the same way we're seeing the Xbox acquisitions of teams being like, no, we acquired you to make the games we want you to make. Like, I think they want Housemarque to make Housemarque games. If Bluepoint turns out they want Bluepoint to make either the remakes or the original games that Bluepoint wants to make, I think if they acquired a smaller, very like idiosyncratic team like Young Horses, it would be like, because we want you to make those games, to like turn them. I guess the closest comparison I can think of, which has been one of my major bummers, is like, you know, on the Activision side, we have a lot of really imaginative, great teams like the Toys for Bob team, who are doing the Spyro and new Crash games, who are now working on Call of Duty. And it like hurts my heart to see the ingenuity and the originality and the creativity that came out of a team within this larger, you know, Activision banner to then just continue now having to work on Call of Duty. And so, yeah, I don't think we see that sort of same thing with PlayStation. I think we see them get to make the games they want to.
Which is kind of different than what you do see with comic book movie directors, because like a lot of them have been very open about being like, this was my movie, and then those parts were the parts that the studio told me to put in so it can connect to the larger cinematic universe narrative.
Of course, it's worth pointing out and talking about, you know, obviously there was the report several months ago that we talked about quite a bit on the show of the worry that Sony was just doubling down on blockbusters at the risk of creative freedom the limitation of risky creativity. But it's at least with these new studios, I think they're requiring them in the sense to let them do what they do best. But in terms of like Sony's interest in continuing to acquire, part of the news of this came out from a GQ UK interview with the leads of Housemarque as well as Herman Hulst. And GQ asked Herman if it feels like we're in the midst of this arms race because Microsoft bought Bethesda, Facebook is scooping up a lot of devs for VR. Is Sony interested in an arms race, and or do they see it as an arms race? And Herman said, quote, no, not at all. We're very selective about the developers that we bring in. Our last new acquisition was Insomniac, which has worked out very well. I'm always looking for people that have a similar set of values, similar creative ambitions, and work very well with our team that we can further invest in and help grow as creators. It's not like we're going around and just making random acquisitions. They're very, very targeted acquisitions of teams that we know well. The amount of collaboration between our external development group and Housemarque on the technical side, the production management side, and even on the creative side has been so deep. So for us, it just makes so much sense to do that. Mm-hmm. Obviously, this is not something you do overnight. We've been working on this for quite a while, but we obviously didn't want to distract the core group at Housemarque that's been working to get this amazing title out, Brian, as you had mentioned earlier. And I think the strongest point that I can bring up about this, that where I get that, like, their current approach is coming from is, like, the I've had those discussions with Herman about Firewalk Studios and Deviation Games, and of course they also are working with Jade Raymond's Haven Studios. Like, they're not acquiring those teams. Those teams are still independent. They're just, these next new games are being published, and that feels like his point about their targeted acquisitions of teams that we know well. And even if those studios are headed by people they know well, like, those are brand new teams. And so it seems like Sony is letting those teams almost, like, figure out themselves a little bit while working with them and still giving them, like, the keys to the kingdom and letting them work with their resources, but not fully taking them on just yet, because it is a risk at that point with a new team.
Right. I think that's why the Bethesda thing felt so surprising for a lot of people, because it didn't really seem like there was, like, a deep history between those companies outside of just sort of coexisting and, you know, supporting each other's platforms and such. Whereas the Sony acquisitions definitely feel like, you know, we have a history of working with you. You've proven to exist well within our ecosystem. We trust you. You know how to, you know, deliver a product that audiences like and critics like and sells well. So I guess, like, to me, it would be more like to see what Sony should acquire, what I want them to acquire in the future. It would be more like filling holes in or gaps in genres and stuff like that they're not truly covering on right now, which, like, off the top of my head, I don't really have a ton that I would think of. Whereas, obviously Microsoft has spent the last few years sort of, like, ramping up and staffing up and getting to a place where they're a lot more comfortable and can go, here's our suite, here's our library, here's our all of our studios, our games. But Sony's been doing that for a very long time, so I think that they're they have a really rock solid foundation. So I actually don't know who I'd want to see them purchase. So maybe that is a good philosophy of sort of being selective, because I don't think they should just go, throw $1 billion at Capcom or something, and go, "Hey, you're ours now."
Yeah, I worry too. I don't want too much consolidation of the industry, because you get into that monopolization issue. I do agree, like, but Xbox made the deal it needed to, and it was a smart move because they needed to shore up having original exclusives to be able to put on Game Pass to be able to get people to want to invest in that as a service. Like, it totally made sense from that perspective, but I agree with you. It was a very funny move coming off of, two PlayStation 5 announced exclusives from Bethesda within,
just money. Like, yeah. Money. That's what mm-hmm. that acquisition was all about.
And again, like, right. Good on them for, securing that safety. Like, that gives Bethesda a lot of safety to be part of such a larger corporation. Like, Bethesda was big, but Microsoft is Microsoft. Right. And so to be part of that larger house, it just makes sense, like, from a financial point, as you're saying, Lucy. Even if the relationship doesn't feel as the same as, like, oh, yeah, Sony acquiring Insomniac is like, that should have happened 15 years ago. Yeah, of course.
Exactly.
Same with Housemarque, and really same with Bluepoint. Like, if that one also proves out to be, which it feels like it will, like, those just feel obvious to me. Mm-hmm. But I don't want them to go say, like, well, we've been publishing a lot of Square Enix, Final Fantasy games exclusively at first. Let's just acquire Square Enix. Like, I don't want that to happen on the PlayStation side.
It would be nice if they acquired FromSoft.
That would be a cool one. They did purchase a minority stake in FromSoft's parent company a while back. So we'll see what happens there. But for now,
Sekiro sold pretty well multi-platform, and I feel like Elden Ring's going to do the same. But we'll see. I mean,
yeah,
this is more money than any of us could ever understand happening constantly with people mm-hmm. who are smarter than us. and more powerful. So I feel like a child just being like,
we're just like, I'm sort of feeling like we're like the Muppet babies. And then you just see the legs, you know?
You just see legs. Yeah. I can't see higher than like the nanny's skirt. I'll pretend it's Star Wars with my friends for a couple of hours.
This is like fourth graders deciding what furniture they want in their dream house. Like this is,
yeah.
What the hell we're talking about.
I'm freaking out about paying rent today and figuring out where that money is coming from. We're not qualified for the $1 million, hundreds of millions of dollars deals.
Sell Bethesda. You can pay rent.
Yeah, just sell them. I have this stock, so I assume it means I own the company. Congratulations to the Housemarque team. I haven't gotten to speak with a few of them with the launch of Returnal. They seem like a really great, passionate group of devs who have been doing amazing work for years, and I'm very excited to see what's ahead for them. And maybe congrats to Bluepoint as well. Hopefully we get to talk with you in the future.
The way to celebrate would be to remaster Bloodborne. I'm just putting that out there. It's a good time.
It's a good celebration.
Just drag and drop it, put it through the graphics processor and make
all those secret skeletons that the people on YouTube found in the walls and such, you know, like bring those guys, those old horses, get those out there.
Volumetric fog. I read that somewhere. I don't know what it is, but it sounds spooky. Put it in Yharnam.
It is a phrase I have definitely heard as well in a GDC talk. Moving on from there, though, of course, whether or not that happens, we'll of course cover it on the show when or if it does. In terms of looking forward a little bit closer to games you can play on PlayStation Plus next month, July's PlayStation Plus lineup was revealed this morning as we're recording, and it includes on PS4 WWE Battlegrounds, which I think is that like sort of chibi WWE game that got released when they said there wasn't going to be a proper WWE game because the developers
I think chibi's the wrong nomenclature. I feel like that is super deformed or SD. Yeah. You know that.
Okay. There's also
DK mode and GoldenEye, basically.
Okay. Black Ops 4, which is not the most recent Black Ops, let alone the most recent Call of Duty. And on PS5, A Plague Tale Innocence, which is coming to...
That is cool.
Is getting a next-gen remaster on PS5 and Xbox Series X in the beginning of July. And so this will be free to PlayStation Plus owners, you know, no additional charge there. I'm really excited. I've heard such great stuff about A Plague Tale, and I've been waiting to jump into it, hoping there would be a next-gen remaster since it came out so late in the gen. And now that we have a sequel confirmed for next year, I really want to jump into this one.
It's apparently, you know, extremely undervalued, so I'm definitely keen to jump into it.
Yeah. One of the best rats games I've ever played.
Easily. I hear it's got volumetric
high praise.
It does have volumetric rats.
Interesting. I'm happy about that one. The other two I'm less happy about, except for to say, like, just put some cool games people may not have heard of before instead of Call of Duty.
I tried to get into that wrestling game on Game Pass because I was like, I'm looking for just, and it's, you know, free to download or whatever. I was like, I'm looking for like a fun sort of like arcadey beat 'em up. It is one of the most like grindy games I've ever played in my entire life. Like it's kind of a bummer because like there's some really cool ideas in the back end of sort of like unlocking. You unlock characters in action figure packages. Like they have like card backs and everything and bubbles, which is super cool. But you have to fight like hundreds of matches to get enough, you know, sweat points or whatever they call them in that game to unlock the men and the women. So yeah, it's kind of a bummer. Just a heads up. It's free to download on PS Plus, or it's part of your subscription, but that is a serious time commitment. So just keep in mind that your time is just as valuable, or maybe it's not. Maybe you're just bored and you want to grind for men. Just do it.
Grind for men. That's a different app. What it's worth, Mitchell reviewed it on IGN and gave it a 5. Saying it works as a shallow party game. You play for an hour, then move on to something else, and that's it. Take that one, with a little bit of caution, but definitely I hope you'll all be checking out A Plague Tale, because I will be too.
If you're a shallow party dude, you're going to love this game.
Shallow party dudes and grinders for men, apparently. Moving on from there, I just wanted to briefly mention, we were talking about the Castlevania Arcade Collection getting rated in a few places. The ESRB rated a Ghost of Tsushima Director's Cut for PS4 and PS5. This comes on the heels of a few reports and rumors of an alleged single-player DLC expansion coming at some point that has been referred to as Ghost of Ikishima. That's makes sense as sort of the type of thing you would put in a director's cut, whether or not, you know, that's all planned for some sort of reveal at a state of play or something else, we don't know for sure. But just wanted to keep that one on the radar because I'll take an excuse to go back and explore that very, very pretty world.
Mm-hmm. I just want to point out on the Runner show, you told us what was on the Runner show. We discussed this before we recorded, but you wrote more ghost stuff, director's cut. And I was like, what is more ghost stuff? That sounds like a great indie game. I can't believe I missed that
more
one.
Ghost.
It's a Swayze movie. They found some new scenes. They're going to re-put it out again. Instead of just doing pottery, they do all sorts of art stuff.
I've actually never seen Ghost, so
it's okay. You don't need to see that movie.
I only know that scene via like Community parodies, weirdly. Anyway, moving on from there, last thing I wanted to bring up was something. Thank you, Max, for pointing this one out. It was a thread that appeared, I guess, overnight in our in U.S. hours regarding things potentially about what it takes for indie games to appear and be promoted and work with Platform X, which is, if you read between the lines, very obviously PlayStation. This thread comes from, and forgive me, I never know how to pronounce it when there's another I in there, so forgive me, but is it Ian or Ian?
Let's just say Ian for like
Ian.
Double Ian Garner. I apologize for butchering your name, but co-founder of a publisher, an indie publisher known as Neon Doctrine, which I will fully admit I was not really aware of them before this thread. But this thread has picked up some steam overnight, where he runs through the. It very clearly came based on his previous tweets after a meeting with Platform X, which he says is will not be defined, but it's the operator of a very successful console and does not have Game Pass. So obviously we're all, it's the, Atari VCS.
Even further dig into that, somebody responded and they were like, I'd be shocked if this wasn't Nintendo. And he responded, be shocked. So that pretty much numbers it down to Sony.
Yeah. There have also been a couple other, developers who have chimed in. Obviously not too many because it seems like these things are related to probably things you sign NDAs for or do, you know, longstanding business deals of. So there hasn't been a ton of developers speaking publicly, but, his thread kind of goes into the difficulties as an indie developer of getting promotion or, you know, putting, promotional push behind your games on the PlayStation Store. Some of the things that he brings up include that they don't really have an ability to manage their games on the store. They said in order to get promotion, you must jump through hoops, beg and plead for any level of promotion. They also don't feel like a blog post is as worth it as they think PlayStation thinks it is, according to them. This is, of course, all alleged based on their conversations. They said wish lists don't really have an effect on the PlayStation Store, whereas they, you know, can surface games on other platforms. So it can, go ahead.
Do you understand that? Because I'm not sure. Because I wish list games every now and then. Because I know when you do it on Steam, they'll ping you when they're like on a sale or a deep discount or something like that. And I don't necessarily know the justification or reasoning for that. Like I think it's I've seen developers say like, hey, wish list our game. Sort of in lieu of like a pre-order, because pre-ordering games digitally is, you know, unless there's an actual value to it, like there's bonus content or something, it's not necessarily something I'm interested in any way.
Sure.
But I don't really know what the purpose is for wishlisting on these sort of e-shops, because it doesn't seem like to do anything significant.
And I think
I presume that there's like a sort of understanding or a promise that if your game gets wishlisted enough times, it receives a certain degree of like surface promotion, right?
Yeah, like right. I think the idea is that, and again, this is something that we're saying not knowing how these deals properly work out, but the as you were saying, Brian, like on Steam, there's the, you know, you wishlist things there and a game that gets wishlisted enough seems to get algorithmically bumped up for people. That is the thing that is part of Steam. I think what he is implying is that doing so on PlayStation doesn't offer any sort of similar net gain. And so it's essentially like a worthless tool. It's hard to say because we don't know anyone who said, oh, I've gotten wishlisted a million times and been able to get promotion as a result. We just don't know the numbers of that.
Right. Because it seems to me like the idea of like wishlisting something a lot of times and then it earns promotion is sort of like it's making something on the rise to popularity more popular. you know, it's giving rich people gift bags with phones in them. And it's like, give those to poor people. You know, like there's like the idea of like something getting wishlisted a lot and then bumping up seems weird, because it's like that still doesn't save any of the sort of like hidden gems or the undiscovered, like really cool games that no one really knows about. Obviously, all these storefronts have a discoverability problem massively, massively, because there's just too many games released and there's some little rectangles you can put there. But
I think like what is really like, you know, I'm working with an indie game dev right now. He's writing a guest editorial for us on like how, I shouldn't talk about it before it's even published, but like about how, you know, the term indie is becoming really nebulous, and it's actually working actively against a lot of indie devs in terms of promotion. And, you know, from my understanding, that's across, like, I'm not saying that there aren't issues with the Sony storefront, obviously there are a lot of like really muddied issues that this guy is raising. But, you know, I think as a general rule, it is really, really difficult to get your indie game, of which is now classified as anything less than AAA, right. You know, promotion on storefronts. Like it's like it, I don't think it's just a Sony PlayStation issue. I think that it's a everything issue. It's like there are no buckets in which to separate indie games in a meaningful way. And I think that that's a broader conversation to be had.
Yeah, and I think Brian, just to the point of the wish list thing, I think the idea is that indie devs use it as a way to groundswell support via social media, which again exposes a problem that is, you know, like across the board of discoverability just being an issue.
Right.
But I think the idea is that the wish listing, when there's enough passion from a small group, it can elevate those smaller games, and then that lets people who would have never seen it otherwise see it on those charts and in a place of prominence they wouldn't have otherwise. Mm-hmm. Again, I think it speaks to just like the fact that people need to go out of their way and really do all this stuff to get any sort of prominence is an issue. I think we can all agree all of the storefronts are just generally have their own problems. I don't think there's any great storefront.
No, even down to the search functionality in a lot of these stores. Like if you type in something like Far Cry, you're going to get dozens of results that aren't even remotely related to that. And obviously those are just two words together, so that really could, like, if anybody who tagged keywords in the back end of their, you know, game description, that might flag that in a search. But it's just crazy to me, like Nintendo had the same problem for a while. One of the things that developers were doing that I think they shut down on the Nintendo eShop was they were deep discounting their games to like pennies, because most people who buy games in the eShop get money in kind of gold My Nintendo coins in return. So everybody always has a couple of like pennies in the wallet or a couple of bucks or whatever. So they would deep discount these games at 90-95% off, drop them down to like a dollar or sometimes a penny. And people would buy them like crazy because they'd be like, oh, that's, you know, at the top of the sales tab or the deals tab, which would then bump it to the best selling tab. And it was sort of like a cheat code. And I remember like there was a lot of really bad games that sold really well because people were like, I'll buy a game for a penny. And then the developers would bump the price back up to the original price. And so you would have this best-selling game at $8 or $9 or even $5. And people would go like, oh, it's one of the best-selling games. It must be good. And it isn't, you know, it just sold really well because it was a penny, because, you know, people will buy crap when it's a penny. And so, yeah, like all of these stores have that problem. It is odd to me, like when you go on like the deals tab or like the folk, you know, the spotlight tab on a lot of these stores, you see Call of Duty and you see Battlefield and you see GTA and a lot of games that don't need help, but also like they're best sellers. So it's sort of like a chicken and egg situation, right? Like, cause you want an audience to buy a PS5 or a Series X or a Switch and jump on the store and then see the biggest, best selling, highest rated games. And it helps keep those things in perpetuity at the top of the charts, but it leaves little room for breakthroughs.
I think outside of like, you know, the broad issues with storefronts as a whole, you know, just reading through this thread, it seems like there's a lot of like issues that this guy is having, and it sounds like others are having with communication from PlayStation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, communication.
And that's an issue, right?
Yeah, which we obviously don't have any insight into how those conversations like go in terms of we don't have those conversations because we're not making games. But two of his biggest problems to me seem to be the as you were saying, Lucy, like the conversations to actually just get promotional consideration, approval, things like that seem to be really stuck in the past. Mm-hmm. And I think his frustration comes from the idea that PlayStation has publicly taken an increased stance to want to support indies, but that the behind the scenes machinations don't necessarily live up to that promise. And some of the things that he points to, as you were saying, Lucy, are like, it can take, you know, not just weeks, but months sometimes to get a response. I believe if that wasn't him, another developer had chimed in to say that of communication for these things. There was some concern over, actual platform featuring, which I do want to bring up some reporting in this, but he mentioned how, all the stores take a 30% cut, but to really essentially get a feature, you have to pay a minimum of a $25,000 US fee to get featured. Kotaku's report on this, sorry, I am playing with a Grookey, so if you see that pop up, that's why there's a weird little green monkey here. Kotaku's reporting also mentioned that from developers they've spoken to, that this seems to be something that is similar on Xbox as well, which, you know, for indie devs can be a large chunk of their budget.
Right.
For some of these devs. And so I think he was talking about sort of the amalgam of all these things with the problem of communication, even something like discounts, like being able to do launch discounts is really not an option for them, at least. They're very limited for them to be able to give their game at a launch discount, which I have seen some games, like most recently, I think Griftlands was available as a like PlayStation Plus discount at launch. But speaking to that, they mentioned things like discounts are hard to be part of future discounts. It's basically you don't get to do it yourself. It's sort of something that they choose when and where those things happen. It's sort of it seems like a web of issues of that boil down to a lot of, Lucy, as you were saying, communication stuff. Max,
that whole like we'll decide how to market your game sounds a lot like how iOS games are published. Like I've heard that Apple's basically like you submit your stuff and they're just sort of like, it's like, when is it going out? And it's like, we'll let you know. And it's like, that mm-hmm. seems yeah. a little bit presumptuous. It bugs me though, because like whenever a new game comes out, indie, AAA, whatever, if I hop on the PlayStation Store, I feel like the top thing I see is either games that came out a while ago and everyone's heard of because they're massive bestsellers, or games that aren't even out yet because they're pre-orders for stuff that just got announced at E3. And mm-hmm. like this happened for like for Final Fantasy Intergrade, I think. And it was, you know, it was still placed pretty high up, but I was looking for it and I was like, this just came out today. Why isn't this front and center? Like, this is one of the biggest things and it's a freaking exclusive to the platform. Like, what are you doing over here? And like, I don't know, if you go to the search and you organize by release date or whatever, like newest first, you can find some stuff that way. But it really is just like, it's completely baffling that there's no like, here's what just came out. It's all of the things. Some of them, right. You know, maybe they're shovelware that costs 75 cents. Maybe it's a PlayStation theme. Just put that somewhere.
The storefront front pages also collate like movie deals and the subscription services like PlayStation Plus and PS Now, which take up huge amounts of real estate. And so like,
also, like they know if you have PlayStation Plus or not, like get rid of it. If you have it, like maybe if I'm paying you money every month, like get rid of the ads and stuff. Like,
well, this while we're soapboxing, this pissed me off the other day too. I got an email from Sony. Do you guys remember before the PS5? Went on sale, there was that thing you could sign up for where they were like
PlayStation Direct. Yeah.
Yeah. And they were like, you can buy a PlayStation directly through us. And I never got the email from them. All these people were like tweeting out beta invites and stuff like that. And I didn't get one. So I ended up getting my PS5 through Amazon. And Sony knows I have a PS5. They know that millions of people can't get a PS5 and can't get one. And they know I've registered. I'm purchasing multiple PS5 games digitally through their storefront. They know I'm a PS. I'm getting trophies on PS5. They know I'm in the ecosystem. Like, I'm not just like faking it using your friends. They send me a thing the other day being like, "Good news, you got approved to purchase a PS5 through us." And I wanted to be like, "I don't need this. Give this to somebody who needs this." So many people want this right now, and they're fighting tooth and nail for it. No, I feel like
maybe you wanted to sell it for $1,000 on eBay.
Yeah, I got that same email too, Brian. I felt kind of like, you know, if I have a PS5.
Yeah,
like,
right? Looking a grift horse in the mouth there.
Griftlands now on PlayStation 4. But
I don't think you could pass those to somebody else, right? Because they were like,
no.
Well, I think they're, the, they
yeah, I think the larger thread, and I think one of the things that at least struck a chord with me, and Max, you were the one who brought it to my attention. So if you feel differently, obviously let me know. But I think like the really stark thing for me was that, especially seeing the reporting that's come out since and probably more to come, is that like there are problems across the board, but PlayStation's does really seem to boil down to, as Lucy was saying, like the communication and the way they, at least this dev, and it seems some other dev take it as like a, we don't need you, you don't need us. And that is an alleged presumption of sort of what those conversations boil down to. We obviously haven't been part of them, but that seems to be like the energy that they're walking away from these compos.
Mm-hmm. I really hope that this, like, absolutely, I don't know, as soon as, you know, this kind of thread gets media attention, I really hope that there are changes made, because this sounds...
Rattle some cages.
But this sounds agonizing looking through this thread. It just sounds, you know, you pour, like, everything you have into making this game and getting it on the PlayStation Store, and then you have to, it's just jump through these hoops where you're sort of doomed to fail. It just sounds so agonizing.
Yeah, I mean, they got rid of the
You know, the drop on the PlayStation blog, where it used to be like a weekly thing that was like, here's everything that came out this week, which was super handy. It was great. You know, I'd skim that every week and check it out. And I understand that not everybody wants to go check out a blog because it's a thing from 2004 or whatever. But now that blog is just like this weird, like, smattering of like, oh, here's a press release about Call of Duty, which I don't need to read that. And then an announcement from Herman Hulst, which seems like a thing, like that's a, you know, proper PlayStation blog thing. And then it'll be like, oh, here's a, you know, here's a thing from, oh, one of the lead producers of an upcoming game talking about his game and what it's doing. And it's like, I guess that's sort of cool, but it's, you know, again, it's a smaller sort of, it's like a paid blog. It's just like a really odd sort of odd platform at this point that could be used as like a sort of, you know, a customer, like a PR mouthpiece, a way to, relate information to the public. It could be, you know, super handy in that sense.
Right.
Yeah. Going back to this thread, I want to say, like, there's a mention in there about how, like, people are assigned, like, case managers or whatever. Like, you have somebody at Sony who's assigned to your game to sort of handle it and be your sort of point of contact. And I've heard about this before from, you know, developer friends. And it sounds to me like like having a social worker. Like, a parole officer. And, like, if you get stuck with one who's not great at their job or doesn't have your best interests at heart, then you're kind of screwed. And if you get with a really good one, then things are awesome. But it's like, you know, there's no way to really tell one way or the other. And it sounds like this guy definitely got kind of the short end of the stick on a number of levels.
Yeah, it sounds like it can be a bit of a crapshoot, because it is worth pointing out, like, especially in this era where they are trying to push things. I think we were talking before the show, but, like, you know, Shuhei appeared on the Jeff Keighley, not E3 show, to be like, here's Chicory that's out today, and a game they're putting some muscle behind because it's a PlayStation 5 console exclusive. And they announced the Salt and Sanctuary sequel on there as a, like, PlayStation loves indie sort of thing. And so it's very clear that, like, some indies are getting, you know, attention and promotion and love from PlayStation. But I think it's a, like, the thread speaks to just the sheer number of devs who you probably don't hear about from the one or two spotlights at a show like Keighley's show, and how they can fight for space on a platform that is arguably supposed to be the biggest console.
It's like the golden touch, right? Like, it comes down from on high and is like, you and the rest of you can go back.
The one thing I'm curious about is, if you launch your game on Steam, do sales there factor into, like, getting Sony's attention? Like, will that get you courted by somebody who's trying to corral more indie stuff to, you know, put on the PSN store? If you want to launch on all platforms at once, which is obviously a great way to get everyone's eyes on it, that's, I can see that being tricky. But if you're like, oh, it's been the number one Steam game for, you know, like, five months or whatever, you know?
I don't know. That's a really interesting prospect, because there's a lot of staggered launches that happen that it seems to be working in their favor occasionally. Like, if you look at, like, Hades, right? Like, that was sort of dominated that conversation on Switch, and now it's coming to PlayStation, and it's like this whole thing. You know, like, I feel like that reignited that conversation, just because that audience wasn't allowed to access it for a long time, and then now can. But that's interesting, because I know I get frustrated when like a big new game comes out and I go to buy it on PlayStation and they're like, oh, it's not here. It's only on Steam and your phone or something. And I'm like, what?
I mean, Supergiant's one of my favorite devs, and they have had a like longstanding with Transistor and Pyre. Like both of those were, you know, PlayStation focused released indies. And then it was really surprising to me to not see Hades come to PlayStation first. Like when it got announced for Switch, I was just happy to finally play it because I don't play much on PC, but like it was really a shock to not see Supergiant's next game come to PlayStation. And obviously I'm not saying there was any issue there with their relationship, but we're in a very strange era for indies, it feels like, at PlayStation, both like publicly and now it seems behind the scenes as well. They have started to put this impetus ever since Shuhei got into his role that is focused on outreach to indie devs as a sign that they were going back to what they did during the Vita years, as we have in a recent piece that went up on IGN that we can talk about in a sec, Lucy. But, you know, those years in the very beginning of the PS4, like indies were put on the same stage as the biggest games, you know, stuff like No Man's Sky was trotted out at several PlayStation games. It's launch notwithstanding.
Maybe a bad example. I'd go with like Luftrausers or something.
I just mean like that was one they put a lot of muscle behind, and they were
right.
They wanted to, and they put, you know, on the first PlayStation 4 E3 that I attended as like a freelancer, they were like, here's 12 big indies coming to PS4, and it was like they had all the devs coming out on stage to play their game for like a minute and did all this quick carousel of things. Like they want to show that you know, outwardly, and I think they're trying to do that again, but it does, if things behind the scenes are not living up to that, those processes do have to change. But again, it's processes we don't have a full insight into. We'll be covering more as we go on. Again, it's very clear there are issues throughout all of the storefronts that are going on. This one in particular is focused on what's going on PlayStation.
I don't know, Dorno. This guy sounds like a pretty big Xbox fan. Maybe he's putting some blood in the water there.
We'll see. But it's something we'll obviously continue to cover as we hear more. Obviously, we haven't heard any comment from PlayStation at the time we're recording this. But should there be any more reporting at IGN or elsewhere, we'll be sure to keep an eye on it. Running a little short on time this week, so I just wanted to briefly mention, I know we took a little bit of time last week, but Lucy, before you left, you were just continuing Ratchet and Clank, correct, in terms of what you've
been playing? Yeah, still, I don't have my PlayStation with me. It's just too heavy to take in my suitcase and lug to New Zealand. But yeah, I was really digging it. I mean, I don't want to, you know, go on about it. I think it's a delight to play. It's got a real theme park vibe. It just feels good to play. And I'm looking forward to getting back to it when I return to the US in 6 weeks. In the meantime, I've got my Switch, so I'll you know, speak to the games that are multi-platform on the Switch.
I don't know. They both seem like pretty portable platforms, in my opinion, but to each their own, I suppose. Brian, what have you been playing since we last checked in?
God, the idea of even bringing a PS5 on an airplane. I played a bunch of Chicory, which is cool. I'm not in love with the art style, but I think it's like really smart the way it handles these sort of like adult coloring book drawings that you then color in on the fly. It's really smart in that like you can sort of sporadically splash some paint across the screen and it'll stay there for the rest of your playthrough. So you'll just like paint some kind of like goat man all crappy looking, and then he just has to like live like that forever until he's dead. It's a very Zelda light, which I totally dig. It's on Steam and PlayStation right now. Watch some videos of it first and get an idea of it, it's you might not be in love with it, but I think it's pretty cool, and I'm excited to finish it. Apparently it's only like 10 hours long. I also started Scarlet Nexus, which I'm about 10 hours in. It's awesome. I haven't really like kind of been hooked by a JRPG in a while, but this one has such, it's so much like the combat is so much different than like your typical JRPG. It feels a lot more sort of actiony, a lot more platinum games. The art direction for the sort of overworld and city is really, really cool. It sort of takes this, kind of hand-drawn perspective on sort of like dense Japanese cities, but then puts you in a lot of underground areas. I'm playing as the female character, which you use a lot of sort of like psychokinesis. So you're constantly grabbing stuff around the environment and throwing it at these just like nightmarish, almost FromSoft-y bosses and enemies. And you level up pretty quickly, and you can just dump all your skill points into like more and more stuff that it really feels a lot more like an action game with the trappings of an RPG than like the other way around, which is probably why I'm so hooked on it, because it's less like, you know, here's long story sequences, here's a lot of like kind of grindy stuff. It's very quick moving, and apparently you can finish the whole game in like 20 hours if you just kind of mainline through it. I'll probably do a lot of the side stuff too, but yeah, I'm really happy to be like just into a JRPG again. It's been a minute. So nice. Yeah, definitely. Check that one out.
I have it downloaded and ready to go, and I just haven't had time to jump in before this episode. But yeah, I definitely want to jump into that one. Max, what have you been up to? What have you been playing?
I finished Ratchet and Clank. Nice. It definitely is. It's harder to play games with the new baby around, but I beat it. I really love that game. I have basically no attachment to that universe of those characters, but it still remains like one of the best looking graphically things I've ever played. And I really... Luz, I think you hit the nail on the head. Like, it feels so good to play, and I think that's something Insomniac is just really phenomenal at, is just absolutely nailing the moment-to-moment sensation of playing the game, regardless of what you're doing in the game, or like, and obviously, you know, you can't just phone that part in either, but like, every weapon in that feels different enough, and it's totally fun in its own way. It kind of has this like Nerf gun sensibility to it, and it's very toyetic in a way I really enjoyed, and I had such a good time running around in that world. I'm really happy that studio is still doing what they do. And I mean, I'm dying to play whatever they do next with Spider-Man or whatever else they have in store, but like, it's just such a treat. Aside from that, I have been playing Wolfenstein 2, which I never got around to when it first came out, but I'm dying to see what Machine Games is going to do with Indiana Jones down the road. Not that we'll be able to play that on the PlayStation or anything, but you know, still thought I'd check out Wolfenstein and just, you know...
It's so good though, right?
De-atomize some Nazis. It's good. Speaking of weapons that feel good. And I think I might also dip into some older Far Cry games. I feel like Far Cry 6 has got my attention, and I want to kind of, you know, just get in there, mess around. I got the first two for dirt cheap. They were on sale, and I was like, yeah, well, why not? I never played the first one. Mm-hmm. So I'll give that a
I'm
shot.
I'm playing the first one too. Yeah. Cause they, I rebought like the first five of them or four of them or something, three and a half, and played through three. And yeah, I was planning on doing a whole block on Far Cry last week, which I forgot to add to the show this week, but this week was packed with news anyway. But yeah, we should definitely get into that, Max, cause I know we both really love Far Cry games.
I desperately want to play more Far Cry 3 because that's like one of my favorite games ever. I think I've like started that game maybe three times and played through it like 1 3/4 times. And it's just like, I could check out a different one. You know, I could play something, something I've only played once.
For sure. We can definitely do a Far Cry block with you guys soon.
Cool.
Ahead of 6, but yeah. Moving on from there, I've been playing a bit of Chicory. I'm kind of taking it like it's divided, I think, into 10 chapters. I've been doing like a chapter a night just as like a cool down, since it's such a relatively, quiet game other than a few moments. I'm pretty close to you, Brian. I don't want to spoil them, but I think you know what I mean.
There are intense things that happened that I was like,
there are shockingly intense that definitely feel evocative of some other indie games, but I don't want to spoil too much. But I'm really enjoying it as a like, I don't consider myself like an artist at all. I feel like I have terrible like artistic instincts, but I've liked that the game hasn't prohibited me from feeling like I can still indulge in the painting side of it. And yeah, I kind of like, it's one of the few games recently where I've just like, I've taken to painting like screen by screen, because it's very like old Zelda-esque, as you were saying, Zelda light, like screen by screen, like the original. I'll just take the time to paint it in and think of like, oh, I kind of want this side to be that color block, and then make the trees this detail and whatnot. And you just kind of like do it. And it's not for an achievement or a trophy and not to complete the game. I'm just doing it to do it. And it's, like you said, adult coloring book, kind of in a nice soothing way like that.
It's cathartic. Sexy.
Yeah. Adult coloring book with no adult themes. Actually, it gets pretty heavy.
I'm pretty sure my parents had one of those when I was growing up.
I will make the breast pink.
Oh, that
wasn't a marker.
Anyway, so yeah, I've been playing that. There is, as far as I know, no nudity in Chicory. But I've been enjoying Chicory quite a bit. And yeah, I've just been playing that. I haven't really been playing too many games because I've been very busy just unpacking or not, as you can see from my background. But other than that, I did want to, before we wrap up, just give a quick memory card story. Memory card, of course, is our weekly segment where you, the viewers and listeners at home, write in with your favorite weird, wacky, happy, sad, whatever memories of your PlayStation gaming life, and we read them on the show. This week's comes in from Shay. Shay wrote in with a Easter Sunday tale from Easter Sunday back in the year 2000. And Shay wrote, "My folks did the usual breakfast and Easter baskets that they had given us, usually with candy and cheap toys or knickknacks, but we also had an egg hunt sprung on all four of us kids by surprise. We had those little plastic eggs you put candy or money in and hide instead of real eggs, because that leads to problems. My parents decided to place those all around the backyard, front yard, and inside the house, all hidden very well. In each egg, there was a small piece of paper. Upon each paper was written a singular letter. There were 20 pieces in total once all were found. We spent what felt like an eternity not only hunting down those damn eggs, but also deciphering some form of or word jumble with my siblings. At only 8 years old and the youngest, I wasn't much help, but apparently I helped the best I could. When all was said and done, the pieces of paper laid out and read PlayStation and Tony Hawk. And the moment that was solved, from behind my couch, my dad pulls out a brand new PlayStation 1 and a copy of Tony Hawk's Pro Skater. We were all so excited, and we played together as happy siblings and ate Easter candy all day." Pretty sure that's amazing. And what, went and snagged like, Metal Gear as well. Yeah.
Yeah.
What a like a perfect day as a child.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, a scavenger hunt that ends in a video game, because normally that would have just ended in some candy, but it ended in candy and a PlayStation.
And I'm going to say, I've said this before. For the Easter Bunny, though, he doesn't usually do that kind of stuff.
Easter Bunny is one of my favorite Metal Gear bosses, though, so.
Yeah, he's normally a bit of a cheapskate, so congrats to you, Shay, on a great Easter haul 2 decades ago now, Jesus. But thank you for writing in with that story. And if you want to write in with a memory card story, you can write into beyond@ign.com with the subject line memory card, and we'll read them on the show. But that's about it for this week's episode of Podcast Beyond. Before we go, you can find me at JM Dornbush on Twitter. You can find Brian at Agent Bizzle, Lucy at Luce O'Brien, and Max at Max Scoville. Mike at Mike Scoville. I don't know who that is. I did want to just shout out, Lucy, we just published a piece about sort of the legacy of the PlayStation Vita that you can go read on IGN. I don't know if you want to say anything about it, but
Exactly. It's a really interesting read about how the Vita was basically this big commercial failure and then turned into kind of like a machine for innovation. And it's really fascinating because it could have just sort of gone into nothingness, and instead it's got this great legacy of like being a game where you can play the best indies. It's a really good read.
So definitely go check that out. Max, anything you want to plug?
Yes. This video I spent a very long time working on finally went up. We launched a new series called Kit Bash Creatures. The first two episodes were sponsored by Dungeons & Dragons Dark Alliance, and they had me making custom monsters based on the monsters in that game. And it's one of my favorite things I've ever worked on. Obviously, the game could have had a better reception, but you can't deny that it's got some cool critters in it. So I'm glad I got to make some of those. And go check that out. It's very cool. And also, the beginning of every month, I put up the biggest game releases and the reviews and review from the last month, which is all the games and all the reviews in one. And way too many games came out in June, and I spent way too long on that video. I think that recorded for like 48 minutes or something stupid like that. And I didn't even do the biggest streaming releases. Akeem took care of that for me. So if you want to find out what's happening in July or what already happened in June, go check all those out, please.
Awesome.
Thank you.
And you're welcome. Brian, anything you want to plug?
I'm shooting a big thing today that I can't talk about yet, which will be cool, I think, for people who are interested in video games. But also, there's a couple things that went up right during E3 that kind of just, got trampled by E3. One, I did a Let's Play of Chivalry 2 with Max in full costume, which is fun. You should go check that out. And also, I built a custom MLB The Show baseball stadium with rapper, singer T-Pain. So that was weird, but yeah, go check those out. They're both really funny videos.
Awesome. And yeah, you can catch us normally every Wednesday at 3 p.m. Pacific on beyond.ign.com, youtube.com/IGN Games, and your favorite podcast services around the world. Thank you all so much for joining me this week. And thank you to Tayo, our producer, for making the show happen. And thank you to everyone listening and watching. We hope you're safe and we hope you're well. And as always, beyond.
Cowabunga.
Beyond.
Beyond.
Cowabunga.